Let's stand to our feet and sing, okay? It's going to be great. We're going to be in God's Word. Shannon Hurley is here. Everybody say, woo! Woo! That will help you. If you're new to us, you will know what that means when you meet Shannon Hurley. About our riches.
Riches I need not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure.
sing this with us. Do you feel the world is broken?
Me too.
Do you feel the shadows deep? So if you can, we're all standing right now. If you can move to your left, please do, and that will free up seats over there. And then as you do that, I'm going to teach you a new song. Now, if you sing it along with me the first time I sing this chorus, then I'll know you've been listening to the playlist. But if not, listen, learn, and then join me. This is really helpful for where we're going in God's Word in Matthew 6 today. It goes like this. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. And I'll trust in him no other. My soul is satisfied in him. Okay, so some of you know it. That's really great. We're going to give it another go. Let's try that chorus again if you can join us. I rejoice.
And I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. And I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone.
Now, if nothing less, just watch these words. It will set your heart up well.
My worth is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross.
Isn't that good? My worth is not in skill.
My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, oh pride and shame. But in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross.
Here's that chorus again.
And I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. And I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him. As summer flowers we fade and die, fade youth and beauty hurry by, but life eternal calls to us at the cross.
I will not boast
in wealth or mine,
no way,
or human.
Father, we are here with that very confession this morning that our soul can be satisfied with nothing other than Jesus Christ. We are prone to forget, to hunger for fame and youth and beauty. But Lord, there is nothing that satisfies like Jesus Christ. We pray that you would redirect our hearts to that great truth this morning as we worship you and hear your word preached. We ask this in your son's name. Amen. Well, allow me to welcome you to Faith Bible Church. You may be seated. My name is John Plesnick. It is a joy to have you here worshiping with us this morning. The man leading us in worship and shortly to join me, his name is Patrick Levis, and we're just a couple of the guys on staff here. And if you're thinking about making FBC your home the way we have, we would highly encourage you to really get connected in terms of communication. It's one of the first things you do. To learn more, you can scan a QR code that may show up on our screen, and that will tell you more about how to get connected to our weekly letter and kind of know and be in the flow of what's going on. There's a lot with student ministries, community groups, all kinds of things that are going to start spinning up in about 2 to 3 weeks. So this is critical right now to get in the flow so that you know what's going on later. One of the things that won't be in there, but we want to highlight for you today, is the birth of another new baby.
Oh,
Abel and Jeanette Guzman had little Abel. So you see them out there.
Did you get the note about the other announcement?
No.
That's my fault.
What are we saying?
But it happened so recently.
I'm mystified.
Did you know that Fern and Sarah just got engaged this week?
What? Wow.
And I think they're going to come to second service. So they're not here right now. But make sure that you... there it is. There's
cool.
The picture.
Yep.
Big news.
That's
okay.
Massive.
Anyway, sorry to interrupt.
No, that's fine. You're
are you
up
first
next,
or me?
Actually.
Okay, we want to put a couple of things in front of you. One of the things we've been highlighting, but it's still here, the New Testament survey class. And I would say join me and about 90 other people who are taking this class. You can get signed up, and we're going to do this awesome walk through the New Testament. It's going to be so good with Nigel Shaler, our own Nige. He's going to do great. It's Monday nights. Starts in August. It's coming. So follow the link and get signed up today to join us.
If you've been to the FPC warehouse and you're worried about how 90 people are going to fit in there, allow me to assure you that Temecula Hills has chosen to host it
right.
And given us plenty of room. So we're very thankful for their just friendship and kindness to us. Today.
What else?
Today.
Today's big.
Today's big.
It's big.
We have our favorite missionary to Africa, Shannon Hurley here from Uganda. Sitting right there. You'll hear from him soon. You'll hear a lot from him soon. We have known and just loved Shannon for years. We were just talking 14 years, which is crazy. And he is extremely effective there and a great preacher of God's words. So you are going to be blessed. If you want to meet his wife and you're here in first service, good luck. No, here's what you need to do, because she's not here. She is going to be leading a little class that's open for any women who are interested during second service. If you want to hear her heart for women, for parenting, for ministry, that is here in room 708 on the quad. Really, you walk past the kids all the way to where you think as you walk back on campus that you're at the other side and you may have to leave, and you'll find room 708, and other women can help guide you there as well. Danielle will be there during second service if you have the ability to stay and you want to hear from her. It's going to be a really sweet time, and then their family will be here during third.
Right after you said that, there was 30 women who just went, oh.
That's great.
Yeah.
It's open
to
you.
That's going to be a packed
so
class.
It was a surprise thing for today, so that's why we're telling you now. So there is also seated among you a number of people who just spent a couple weeks with Shannon in Uganda, and I honestly don't know where they are or how many of them are here right now. So if you were on the Uganda team, could you just stand up, let us see who you were. They're scattered. There they are. All right, so these are the people. Thank you, guys.
Get a visual.
So here's the thing. There's one Shannon, and he's great to talk to, but there's a whole lot of others that are also going to be on the patio. If you want to learn more about Uganda, you can talk to any of them after first service, and they will answer all the questions and tell you that, no, Shannon's a little scary. Don't talk to him. So it's fine. But
they'll be the buffer.
They're worth, yeah. So find one of them if you can't make it to him. Now.
Great. Yes.
July 31st is also a special day.
Next week, John.
No, is it?
Yes, next
okay.
week.
So next Sunday, we are going to the beach for beach baptisms after church.
Yes.
And that's going to be fantastic.
Yes. I know, Johnny, I'm pumped.
You can be happy about it. It's okay. So let's try it again. Next Sunday, we're going to the Woo! Beach. I know. So we're going to do beach baptisms. We have people share their testimony here because you can't hear them over the waves. And today we get to hear Del Long share his testimony.
Come on, bud. Yeah.
Del is going to be baptized next week, which is the best. So, Del, tell us how you came to know and be saved. What was your life like before Christ?
Before Christ, I grew up in a Christian home with my dad, mom, and older brother. My parents taught us the gospel, and we went to church every Sunday. I never truly understood the depth of my sinfulness and what Jesus did for me on the cross. Since I was surrounded by Christians in the church, my church friends at school, I never really saw my desperate need of Jesus to rescue me from my sins as my one and only Savior. I thought I was a Christian too, but I was secretly being controlled by my prideful and jealous heart. In summary, I was a very typical young man who grew up in a Christian home who thought I was a genuine believer.
All right, and that was here. I remember these days. So how did God save you? What happened to change you?
It wasn't until my first winter camp when I realized my sinfulness after my D group leader at the time shared the gospel with me during a one-on-one. I realized I was a fake and needed to be genuinely born again. That's when I realized I was a wretched sinner, and I came before the Lord and confessed and repented for my sins. And I put my trust in Jesus Christ alone. I gave my life to Christ, who gave up his life on the cross for my sin because of the immense love he has for me. His death and resurrection is the only way I can be forgiven, by putting my trust in him for salvation. Ephesians 2:8-10 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them."
Yeah, so God shows you your sin, reveals your hypocrisy, you repented, you've been transformed. How have you seen God at work in your life from that first winter camp up until today?
After I give up my life to him, I am no longer a slave to my sin, and I desire to grow in dependent obedience to him every day. I know there is still indwelling sin in me, but I'm confident that I'm a new creation in Christ with the desire to please him and give him glory in all that I do. I hope to serve the church and the college ministry with all the hope of bringing others to people in Christ by being a light to the gospel to others. Matthew 5:16 says, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven."
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Great job, man.
Awesome.
All right. That's like the best part of our worship services when we get to hear testimonies. As a part of our worship, we greet one another, and if you're new to FBC, this will be fun for you. We'd like to take a couple of minutes and actually see how one another are doing. So will you stand to your feet, greet somebody maybe new to you, and then we'll bring you back and get into God's Word.
Makama Yeba Zibwe. All right, we just found out who's been to Uganda and who hasn't. Well, what a joy it is to be here. My name is Shannon Hurley, and I'm your missionary to Uganda. And I was singing with John Paul, 14 years this church has supported us, and I want to thank you for that. Can we clap for that? There are as well individuals in this church that have been supporting us that many years, and so we feel so blessed to be part of this church. And they even said, you just come up, don't worry about an introduction because you're part of the family, and we feel that. We absolutely love Faith Bible Church and what God is doing here. And we praise the Lord for all his work. It's fun because we've seen many of you guys in high school camps back at Lake San Antonio. Come on, anyone from there? Come on, the good old days, the glory days, right? But back then, I used to speak at the camp. It's funny, I've not spoken at a camp since then. But we'll call them to repent. No, what a joy, though, it is to be someone who gets to come up here, be given the pulpit. We know that that's an honor, and so we praise God for that. We have been serving the Lord in Uganda for 16 years, and we have so much going on over there. We have two missions. One is to reach our community for Christ. A second is to strengthen churches throughout Uganda. And in God's kindness and his care, I mean, we went over there not knowing really anyone in a time when things were not very safe at all, and God has sustained us all of these years. God is good, amen? This week, we're dropping off two of our kids. One of them was 3 years old when we went to Uganda. We're dropping them off at university. And so it's crazy to see how God cares for us, isn't it? And all of these years through the valleys and through the mountaintop experiences we have, God's loving care remains so faithful. And we praise the Lord for his kindness to us. But in these 16 years, we have seen God just do incredible things. And today we have a church just like this. We have a church that has between around 500 people coming to worship every Sunday from a village community. And so God is good, amen? We have a primary school that has 560 kids, all from our community, that we're able to disciple to know and love Christ. And God is just richly blessing in his kindness. We have a pastoral training center that is 70 men that are just now finishing the foundation stage of our training center for pastors. We're getting ready to launch phase 2 and phase 3, which will involve bringing their families. And so God has been so good, so kind, so unbelievable. And in many ways, I want to come this morning. I just want to share my heart with you as to what passage. I'm trying to think, what passage would I want to give Faith Bible Church out of my love and care and concern for them? And it's the passage that we're looking at hand. Before I go there, you've gotten my prayer card. This is so that you what? Oh, okay, this is so that you what? This is so that you pray. So we ask that you would pray for us. We would ask that you would really just dedicate your heart to, in your quiet time, when you spend time with the Lord. I don't know, some of you, if you love eating, put it on a refrigerator. If you love brushing your teeth, put it near your sink. I don't know, but we ask that you pray. Pray that we would love Christ with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind. Pray that God would give us wisdom. Pray that God would continue to just allow his name to be spread throughout Uganda. Can you pray that way? We would ask that that would be the case. For those of you that say, Shannon, we want to get involved in SOS one way or another, I would ask, on here is our website. First of all, I would ask everyone here, our website is here. If you go to our website, sosministries.com, you can go to the bottom and you can get our newsletter. And just get our newsletter so we can encourage you in Christ and we can just pump you up to live for the King today here in Marietta. And second thing, if you want to get involved one way or another, we have about 100 kids that need to be sponsored for our primary school. So just like compassion, but better, because all of your money goes there, you can sponsor a kid through our website, and the missions table will have information about that and the like. But please consider jumping. I'd love for 30 of those kids to be taken off my mind because you guys decided to step up and support those kids. Could we do that? 30 kids, what do you think? Faith Bible, you think? Good. I would love to see that. And then you come on a missions trip. John Plesnick is leading, right? John Plesnick? Someone is going to lead that next missions trip. And we would love for it to be any of your pastors because we love them all. I think Chris should lead the next one. It's been a long time. How many think Chris should lead the next one? Don't let him tell you he's old now. Don't let him go there. Anyhow, we give that to you to ask that you do that, ask that you help us in that way. I want to pray, and then I want to jump in and have a little family time around God's word. Can we do that? Let's pray together. Father, you are glorious. You are reigning above all the heavens on a throne, ruling in all your majesty, all your glory, all your goodness flowing from that throne. With all the power, you reign over all of the events of this world. And we stand in awe of you. And Father, we are here as Christians with bended knees saying that we are servants of your majesty. But we live in a world that's filled with rebelliousness toward you. Evilness dominates the society in which we live, and we want to live with reckless abandon for your purposes, but it's not easy because we fail to remember your gospel call that you desire everything because you love us fully. And you stand above this universe calling all to come to you for our good. And we would ask that in your goodness and grace that you would open our minds and our hearts to the truth of your word this morning, and we'd see the sweetness of your son's message to the people of Israel. We love you. We look to you. Guide us and aid us this morning, we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to start our time by reading a hymn from Isaac Watts, the grandfather of hymnology. I want you to listen to these words that were posted in 1721, and I want you to see how different they are in mentality from our modern perspective. Are we ready? Am I a soldier of the cross, a follower of the Lamb? And shall I fear to own his cause or blush to speak his name? Must I be carried to the skies of flowery beds of ease while others fight to win the prize and sailed through bloody seas? Are there no foes for me to face? Sure, I must fight. If I would reign, increase my courage, Lord. I will bear the toil, endure the pain, supported by thy word. Thy saints in all this glorious war shall conquer though they die. They see the triumph from afar by faith's discerning eye. When this illustrious day shall rise and all thy armies shine in robes of victory, through the skies, the glory shall be thine. This hymn conveys the heart of believers of old who understood that they were servants of the King. Servants of the? Of the? Oh, that sounds good. Thank you. And they were willing to die for that service. They had this insatiable, unquenchable passion to please their master and an undying commitment to his service. They understood that they were in a battle. They were at war. And this war was bigger than just themselves. They understood that they were living in God's kingdom here on earth, His universal kingdom. And they were committed to living for that master who was on that throne, committed to living for eternal purposes, not for the earthly momentary pleasures. They had an eye toward the eternal kingdom yet to come, and lived to use all their God-entrusted resources toward that sole purpose of exalting their master. And when you hear such a hymn and such a mentality today, we can't help but ask ourselves this question. Were they balanced? Should I live with such a mentality? See, in our culture today, Christianity is bombarded with this idea that, you know what? You can love Jesus, but you can also love many other things. This mentality is killing Christianity, killing us to be effective in our walk with Christ. Is the mentality of 300 years ago, is it the same mentality that we should have today? If we're honest with ourselves and we look deeply in our hearts, we can be honest that we live for many different things other than Christ our King. Many of us live for work. And I want you to be honest with yourself. What do you live for? Many of us live for school, or we live for play, or we live for play, or we live for play. I often say what is a passion in Africa is money, but the passion in America is pleasure. The next movie, more pleasure. The next food, more pleasure. In Africa, many live to survive. But what should a true follower of Jesus Christ live for? Well, the verses before us answer that sweet question. As you can see in your handout, what I want to do today is I want to show you Jesus' two commands. His two what? His two commands, followed by three illustrations. Three illustrations, and this will lead us to see the heart of Jesus for us. The heart of Jesus and for our service to His Majesty. I want you to see it. I want you to see it for your good, for your joy. The passage that we want to look at is Matthew 6, 19 through 24. The first command is in verse 19, and I will give you the context as we move along, but look at the command given. Are you ready? Are you ready? Thank you very much. Verse 19, this is what our master says, and hear his command to us. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on... Let's try that again. Come on, we can do it. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Here's the first command. Do not store treasures on earth. Do not store treasures on earth. When you look at this passage, you think, well, what in the world is he meaning? What is he talking about? Well, the context determines it, shares with us what he means. It's interesting because in chapters 1 through 4 of Matthew, he declares this message, I am the King, I am the King, I am the Messiah. I'm your Messiah. And then in chapters 5 through 7, he tells us how we are to live. The Beatitudes, right? The heart of a true follower of the King. And what happens as he tells us of who we are as followers, he tells us how he wants us to live. Look with me in chapter 6, verse 1. Beware of practicing your what? Your righteousness before others in order that they to be seen by them. Don't do that. Don't practice your righteousness before others. For then you will have no what? No reward from your Father who's in heaven. So don't practice your righteousness before others because there's no what? No reward. What he does, he gives three illustrations from there. He gives an illustration of praying. First one is, of giving. When you give, don't give to be seen or your reward is in full. But instead, when you give it to God. Don't let anybody know what's taking place. Then he goes and he gives an example of praying. When you pray, don't do it before the eyes of others. But when you pray, go to a closet and pray, and your reward in heaven will be full. Then he gives a third example of fasting. When you fast, don't do it before others, or your reward is full. But rather, when you fast, do it before what? Do it before God. That's the context before this. And what's beautiful is then he says this, do not store treasures in what? On this earth. Don't do it. So what is he referring to? According to the immediate context, these treasures on earth must be referring back to the earthly rewards given to hypocrites. As a result of their service they perform before the eyes of man. And based on this context, these earthly possessions consist not only of honor that comes from being seen by men, but it includes also physical possessions. Why? Because moth and rust can what? Destroy. So these earthly rewards that they're looking for is the honor they're going to receive, or the rewards, physical rewards they're going to get from people. Don't live for those things. And the idea here is the idea of storing up or stockpiling. Don't take the earthly possessions, the honor given to you by people, and stockpile those earthly rewards. This is the heart of what Jesus is saying. I don't want you to live for others. I don't want that. I don't want you to live for the pleasure and your own fame. I don't want that. Don't do it. But then he comes to a second command. And let me just say this before I give you the second command. Jesus is clear that he doesn't want them to be like the hypocrites that are around them. And listen, I know that we are an evangelical church. But Jesus is saying this because this is true in all of our hearts, right? We can all do things for the eyes of others. Oh, there's the guy that makes so much money and gives it to the church. Oh, there's the guy that serves every week. And we can easily be motivated for earthly fame instead of heavenly joy, right? And this is what he's addressing. Don't be like those hypocrites. Don't be living for this present world. Don't live with your eyes on people. Don't, in a stupid way, stockpile things that don't last. Don't live for them. Don't live for such treasures. These treasures are only temporary and have no lasting value. Instead, what are you to do positively? Look at the second command in verse 20. The second command in verse 20 is this, but lay up what? Lay up for yourselves treasures on treasures in, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be. The second command is clear. Don't do this, but instead store up treasures where? Where? Look at your neighbor. This is what we do in Africa. You're doing it here. Tell them, store treasures in heaven. Go ahead. I caught a newlywed couple kissing instead of talking to each other. Man alive, I like it. I like it. Well done. Sousa. Of course it's a Sousa. For what shall we live? For what shall we live? Now listen. This here is a command. This is a command for you as a disciple of Jesus Christ to live for heaven. Rather than living for earthly treasures, Jesus commands his followers to live or stockpile treasures in heaven. According to the context, this is done by performing your righteous service in secret before the eyes of God. It is through secretly giving to God alone, secretly praying to God alone, secretly fasting to God alone. It is through doing any righteous deeds to love God, his people, with the motivation of pleasing God and giving honor and glory to him and not you. This is the driving heart behind Christ for all of his children, is that we would live for the eyes of him and him alone, for the eyes of him and him, that would be the driving motivation, that we would take our secular worlds and find out a way to make them heaven-bound, king-oriented. That we would turn our current universe into an understanding that we have a master on a throne and everything we do are for his purposes. And anything given to us are to be used for that kingdom advancement. Rather than stockpiling on earth, we are to stockpile where? In heaven. And what I love is everyone can pray. Can't we? It's not about money. It's about your life and your time and your resources and whatever you have living for the glory of our Master. He's demanding that we live to proclaim his excellencies. Him who called us out of darkness and into his light, we now no longer live for Satan, no longer live for the world. We now live for Christ, and we live for his kingdom. And notice that he's contrasting his point. He's comparing how ridiculous it is to live for this present world where moth and rust destroys, thieves break in and steal, versus living for a future reward that's untouched by anything, but reserved in heaven awaiting us. When I preached this first in Uganda, and I told my brothers and sisters in Uganda that this gives us great hope as Africans. And I said, because what you don't know is that you can be extremely rich in this present world and poor, if you will, in comparison in the next. While others can be exceedingly poor in this world and super abundant wealthy in eternal life. Bible's ongoingly speaking of the stupidity of riches and trusting in those and living for those. Proverbs 11:4 says, riches do not profit in the day of wrath. Proverbs 23:5 reveals that when you set your eyes on money, it is gone. For wealth certainly makes itself wings like an eagle and flies toward the heavens. Luke 21:12-21 declares the same truths, or 1 John 2, 15 through 7, which says that we as Christians, we don't live for this present world, but we live for what? For our Father, for the things above. We don't love these things because we know they're passing away. Dear friends, hear this loudly and clearly. To live for heaven is not everyone becoming missionaries or pastors. To live for heaven is to use whatever resource you have to love and serve God. It's to change the motivation for why you do what you do. You see, you can be a good student for personal fame, or you could be a good student for the purposes of honoring your master and getting trained perfectly and well for his service. It's all about the motivation. Does that make sense? And so when you change it for him instead of for you or for the eyes of others, that's the game changer. It is you using your time, your energy, your money, your mind, your pen, your skills, and so on for the purpose of loving people with the motivation of glorifying and honoring your master. If you're a teacher, it's using your knowledge to invest in students' learning with the motivation of serving God. You never were serving that boss anyways, right? We live not to serve the boss, but to serve our King, and doing it all as unto him. And just that simple transaction in your mind changes everything. Because I'm no longer doing it for a paycheck. I'm doing it for a master. Listen, I'm not telling everybody they got to go dump all their money into the church offering plate. If that's what God would call you to, great, do it. But what I'm saying is that it's changing our motivation for the money, our motivation for our work, our motivation for our parenting. The casual worker using his energy for God, by serving as boss, he stores treasures in heaven. The older lady who's at home is saying, I don't have a lot of energy, but I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray for our missionaries. I'm going to pray for this, pray for that. That is living for heaven. Can you wash dishes for your mom out of love for God? That's storing treasures where? Can you disciple someone else and help them know Christ? That's living for heaven. Can you give resources to your local church or to help missions? That's living for heaven. What is done for God is rewarded in heaven. Now, I want to go from these two commands to why. Why does Jesus make such a radical demand of his followers? Why? The answer is found in three illustrations. Verse 21 is that first illustration. Look with me at verse 21, and you see it begins with a for. For, he's explaining the why. For where your treasure, what? There your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The first illustration is that of a treasure. And here's the principle. I want you all to, with one hand, grab your heart. With the other hand, grab something, okay? What you decide to grab, the treasure you grab will grab your what? The treasure you grab will grab your. If you treasure making money, money will grab your. If you treasure being a professional athlete or sports will grab your. Are we together? What you treasure will be what your heart treasures. funny because when you listen to men talk and just hang out, what do they normally talk about? It's either sports or what? Or their job. Why? Because that's what they treasure. That's what they do with their day, right? If you talk to moms, what do they normally talk about? Kids. Why? I don't know why they're not talking about us, men. Come on. But they usually talk about kids. Why? Because it's kids that they what? That they treasure. It's kids that they treasure. You see, what you grab will grab your heart. For young people, when you grab and it's like that girl, or movies. When you come together, all you talk about are movies. You know what I want? I want to come back as a missionary, sit down with people and talk about Jesus. But you know how hard that is? We want to talk about everything else other than Jesus Christ, other than living for our master. Why? Because we're not treasuring our master. We're not treasuring kingdom purposes like we need to. And let me just say this. I'm saying this as a missionary so you could think, oh, Shannon, he's got it figured out. Listen, this is an ongoing battle for what? All of us. But the principle must be seen, and it only gets sweeter as we move through here. What you treasure is what will fill your heart. For our hearts are filled with what we what? What we treasure. And listen, why does Jesus command and then give this illustration? Let me tell you why. Because he wants to be what we what? What we treasure. He wants to be what we treasure. So he wants us to grab him and service for him instead of the world. Because he doesn't want the world and the things of this demonized society to grab what? He wants himself to grab us. In Uganda, we find people treasuring many different addictions. They're addicted because they treasure their alcohol. They treasure their pornography. They really think it alone will bring pleasure. Every time there's a problem, where do they turn? Alcohol or pornography to just satisfy them and to find joy. Instead of turning to what? Christ. As a Christian community, Christ must be the center of our hearts. Therefore, living for him in heaven must be our greatest aspiration. I love the story told of Martin Lloyd-Jones. He speaks of a farmer that joyfully runs into the kitchen to announce that his finest cow had given birth to twins. Now, I understand this better because I live in a society that doesn't have much, but a cow is money, okay? So when you produce cows, you sell those cows. So he's excited because two cows were born. One of them was white and one of them was brown. And he felt inclined that in light of this, I want to give one of these cows to the Lord. His plan was that he would let both of them grow up big and live and become big in size, and then he would sell one of them and keep the proceeds from one and give the proceeds of the other to the Lord, or sell both of them. So his wife said, so which cow is the Lord's cow, the white one or the black one? He responded by saying, it doesn't matter now, let's just raise them together. A month goes by, and the farmer comes back into the kitchen to see his wife, but he comes slowly and sadly. He says to his wife, I have bad news. The Lord's cow has died. So often this is how we look at life. We look at our relationship to Christ. We will give him all the extra if there's extra. We'll give him the leftovers, the surplus. But Jesus Christ demands his followers, demanded Israel, demands all those who are children of his king, of his majesty, to love him with the first fruits, their finest parts. Why? So that their heart would be his. Interesting, when you look at the Old Testament and you look at these ideas of those who were valiant in their devotion to the Lord and those who were not. Regarding Rehoboam, it says this in Second Chronicles chapter 12, verse 14. It says, he did evil because he did not set his heart to seek the Lord. Why did he do evil? He did not set his heart to seek the... Listen, if we don't set our hearts for Christ, forget it. You will do what? Evil. What sets the men of God separate from all the rest of humanity is their heart, and their heart longing after God. People ask me, Shannon, how can we pray most for you? I'll quote for them that the eyes of the Lord look to and fro throughout the earth to strongly support those whose hearts are completely his. Pray that my heart is always, continuously, completely his. And I fight like everyone fights, that my heart would be his. And the distractions of our lives would not hinder us from our first love, from the one thing necessary, and that is to sit at the feet of Jesus Christ. Listen, dear friends, the first illustration is clear. And so understand it by the authority of Jesus Christ, that what you grab, what you treasure, will grab your heart and your life. What is it that you treasure? What have you set your heart on? Is it Christ? There's a second illustration given to us in verses 22 and 23. It's the illustration of an eye. An illustration of an eye. In this illustration, he says this, and I'm going to, for the sake of time, be quick on it, but he says this: the eye is the lamp of your body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? Obviously, I'm not giving you an exposition on all elements of this just for the sake of time, but I would say this: this illustration of an eye is clear. If you, what you look at and what you put your eye to is what will fill your heart. And so if your eyes are meditating on what is good, then what is good will fill your heart. If your eyes are meditating on what is bad, then bad will fill your heart. The human eye, in relationship to the body, represents the same relationship a believer has to Christ. Just as an eye controls a body, so a treasure controls a heart. I like giving the example of a sponge. If I take a sponge and I dip it in water, and I pull out that sponge, and I wring out the sponge, whatever I soaked it in will what? Come out. My brothers, my sisters, the same is true here. Whatever we saturate our minds in, whatever we devote our hearts to, will come out. Will come out. And that's why so many of us are struggling in our relationships to Jesus Christ, because we spend all day meditating on whatever is here. Satan has us. And these are important for work purposes. But what we find is that everything that's saturated our minds are our friends and sports, and because it's all the notifications are all coming to us, right? So we can't keep our minds steadfast on Christ because all these other things are what we put our eyes on. Christ or the world, Christ or friends, Christ or money, Christ or girls, Christ or bad movies. Listen, today, everybody, any free time we get, what do? We go watch a? And is that promoting Christ or promoting other things? And you say, Shannon, you're saying these things are bad. No, I'm saying, listen, what you treasure is where you're, and what Jesus wants is he wants our hearts. So we have to say no to things that we might say yes to another. What we meditate on will control us. What we meditate on will control. So what are we meditating on? Let's do things as activities instead of devotion to those things. I went the other day and watched Man City United in Texas. That was awesome. But it's an event. I didn't read every article about Man City United beforehand. We have to learn, how do we set our minds on Christ? It means we have to get our distractions pushed aside that Christ might be our all in all. If we give ourselves the heavenly treasures will dominate our hearts and lives. That's why our greatest prayer needs to be that of the hymn writer. Once earthly joy I craved, sought peace and rest, but now thee alone I seek. Give what is best. This is my earnest prayer. More love, O Christ, to thee. More love to thee. Last picture given, last illustration given here is that of, or illustration is that of a master. That of a master. Look with me in verse 24. Powerful. Powerful. He says this, no one can serve two masters. No one can serve what? For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money or manna or food. Here is a clear illustration of a master. You can only serve one master at a time. And whatever master you serve is your master. And this is the heart of the issue for Jesus Christ. Who's your master? Didn't Jesus command in the Ten Commandments to love him with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our minds? What does Jesus want? Is he wanting our bad here? Oh, live for him as a drudgery. No, live for him as a joy. He wants our greatest joy. And so therefore he says, let me be your greatest master. Because when we do things his way and for his service, it gives us the greatest joy. And so what he's saying to these brothers and sisters, listen, you can't serve two masters. Hear me, young people. You cannot serve two. You can't. Oh, brothers and sisters, and if this is any heart that I want to get to us, it's this reality, because many of us are trying to live for Christ, but we're trying to love the world at the same time. We think, okay, we can go do this and this like everybody else, but still love Jesus Christ. And what you find, slowly, Christ has less and less and less of you. That's because we don't realize this truth, that you can't serve two masters. Look what he says positively. You need to be what? Devoted to one. You need to love one. And be devoted to it. Love it. And to be devoted. Do you love Christ? Do you love him? Is he your master? Do you hunger after him? Is he your longing? Do you love him? Is he what grabs your heart in the morning and carries it throughout the day? That's what it is to love someone. Am I right? Are you devoted to him? But listen, not only that, you say, well, I want to be devoted. I want to be. That's great. But the question is, and you hate the what? You hate the other, despise the other. You see, this is our problem. We don't hate the world. We love it. We don't hate all these things that grab our hearts. We don't hate them. But in Christ, we have to hate these things that grab our heart, that Christ might have our whole heart. Are we together? You can't serve two masters. Who is your master? If it's Jesus Christ, my brothers and sisters, then let it be Jesus Christ. Then let's dedicate and meditate on him fully and give him everything that we have, all that we are, for all that he is. Amen? This is the text. And then he goes on to talk about worry. He says, don't worry, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. We aren't like the Gentiles who seek after these things. We're those who seek the kingdom. My brothers and my sisters, my dear friends, I live in the same world you live in. And I think I get a greater sense of it because I'll come from Africa and I'll come here. The second I get on a plane, boom. Every movie that's being presented is there. And they're not good. And listen, I like them. Just like everybody else. I like the lust that comes from there. I like living the experience that actor's living. It's easy to like them. And so what do I need to do to tell my own heart? I hate it. I want nothing to do with it. Lord, help my eyes to not see it. Because it will take me away from loving who? Jesus Christ is my greatest love. We have one life, dear friends. One life, and it's a short one. Can't we take this life and hate everything that Christ hates and love everything that Christ loves? Can't we do that? That our gift to him as a result of the saving work that he is on our heart is a heart of love and devotion to him. Brothers and sisters, you must hate whatever is grabbing your heart, whatever treasure is grabbing your heart other than Jesus Christ. And you must devote yourself fully to him. I'm concerned. I ask many of my dear friends about spending time in the Word each day. And commonly, well, you know, I struggle. I try to spend 30 minutes with Christ in the morning. You try. Are we children of the King or not? If you can't spend 30 minutes with Christ, how are you going to love him as your greatest treasure? Listen, according to this passage, you won't. And what does Christ want? He wants to be your treasure. He wants to be at the center of your eye. He wants to be your exclusive master. Listen, do not think you can love two masters. You can't. You must crucify the one and devote yourself to love the other. I am excited to be 47. I'm 47 now, 16 years on the mission field. I'm excited now because at this stage in my life, my kids are graduating, and I get to see the fruit of my life. I get to see kids love Christ in Uganda. I get to see my own kids. And let me tell you, the joy of loving Christ far surpasses anything else. May God and those of you who are serving him faithfully, don't give up. Keep throwing away the distractions. And let's together love Jesus with all our heart and just look at the fruit that's produced as a result of that. Guys, we love you, and it is a joy to serve you in Uganda. May the Lord bless you. Let me pray. Father, we come sadly because you want our hearts. And so often we give you just a part of us. We keep believing the lie that we can somehow serve two masters instead of showing the supremacy of your person by our singularity of focus and devotion to you as our master. Lord, we cannot control the things that happen in our lives, but we can control our lives in terms of how we, what we love most. Father, will you make yourself our greatest love? Will you help us to crucify and hate and despise anything that would take our affections away from you? Will you help us store treasures in heaven? Father, we love you. You are our God. And we love you with the affections of our hearts. Help us live out this truth now, we pray. For the praise, glory, and honor of your name, we pray. Amen.
I think we're all saying amen to that. So you can do it out loud. Go for it. Amen, amen. Let's stand to our feet. We got just a minute here, but I feel as though we must sing in response. Continue to set your heart towards this good challenge that we've got. How rich a treasure we possess, Jesus Christ our Lord. His blood, our ransom and defense, His glory our reward. The sum of all created things is worthless in compare. For our for a second. Let's sing as a congregation. For yours is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the power,
and the glory. Amen.
Good. I want to
wanted you to have the benediction. Remember that as you go. All right, so I'm going to let you out those doors in just a moment. Follow the QR code. If you're new with us, get on that church app. That's the way you can stay connected here. Today, on the patio, since the Hurleys are with us, and also we want to do this regularly throughout the year, our missions table is up. Shannon will be there. The Uganda team from this summer will be out there. Go stop by there. Learn about the Hurleys, Uganda, and our other missionaries. And pray, pray, pray. That was the challenge earlier. I thought that was great. If you have questions, need to connect, or need counsel, there's an awesome couple over at the exit doors. There's the Munozes, Shannon and Manny. So stop off there if you have questions, things that you've heard today, ways that you have not yet gotten connected. We want to connect you in, so talk to the Munozes. They'll help you out. Today, our college ministry is providing, check this out, cold brew coffee. So if that's your thing, they have three lines set up so they can get you through it as quick as possible, but be patient. They've got enough coffee, I think, for about 650 of us. So they're going to provide it for you. And then the kiddos get Otter Pops. And Sean Farrell told me there's lots of sugar for the Levis girls. Oh, man. Okay. Thank you. Anyways, enjoy those. Fellowship together. Please love one another as you go. Hold on to these things and apply them. Apply them in life.